Hello everyone, my name is Momo, and I don't know, I'm just going to discuss some anger, simply because I'm not finding an outlet for it, I'm not finding any channels on it, I'm just, don't know, I just thought I'd make one and see where that goes. Anywho, I thought, might as well. So, without further ado, we're just going to be discussing rarities today. Now, how am I going to be discussing these? Well, I'm going to be discussing the author, how they're doing, if they're still publishing, the publishing company, if they're still alive, whatever they're doing, how they are, their current status, as well as price. And the price tag doesn't really matter so much, but it's still something I want to throw in there just to keep things informative. Now, first one up is Deco, the zombie shop. Now, this zombie shop is fantastic. Done by Mr. Jamie Kamoto, this manga itself is such a delight to the senses. There is meat to this bone, there is blood, there is gore, there is macabre everywhere, and it's going to be filled with a lot of puns from me at least. But when it comes to Mr. Jamie Kamoto, we discuss such fantastic works as Iron Ghost no Shoujo, as well as Shimamaru Sukuban Chainsaw, both fantastic works, fantastic art, fantastic visuals, fantastic engrossment of everything. Now, when it comes to Deko the Zombie Shop, it was a phantasmagoria of guts and artwork. Now, as palpable as it may seem for some, of course it's not for everyone. When Dark Horse Comics came out with this little gem, it was only translated into 6 volumes of the 11. After those 6, it was dropped for whatever reason. Dark Horse Comics has not stated any reason why. Perhaps it wasn't some people's cup of tea, perhaps sales were doing not so great. Unsure, no comment from them at all. But the first 6 volumes that do remain translated are a bit of a rarity, since after Dark Horse dropped them, for whatever reason, they were never picked up by any other licensing again, which to me is a bit of a drab. He does not just dabble in manga, he does dabble in film. Now, Sukuban Chainsaw is a fantastic work of art in the visuals that they bring on board for film. Now, this film was done not too long ago. Now, the visuals, the colors, the schemes, everything, the blood, the gore, it's there, it's still there. They brought that on board. Now, if you look at this film, which I do recommend watching, supporting this artist, it is fantastic. There is that element that you can only derive from a Mikamoto artwork. If you are engrossed by this, by all means, you can also check out his other film, Big Boom Zombie. Now, this one's derived from his work, Big Boob Dragon, which I don't. It's silly, it's funny, it's one of those things that you probably shouldn't watch with anyone home at all. Not even your cat. But I suppose this does have a fan base, as well as a plot. Lots of plot. I don't know. I'll let you guys decide that one. But besides that, moving on. Deko the Zombie Shop takes place in a zombie shop, a necromancy shop run by Deko, which is just your regular high school girl with powers of necromancy. Now, her job is for a very handsome fee for money. She revives the dead for some time to let them deliver any last messages, any last tidbits, any last facts that she or they would have wanted to pass along, but never got the time to. Now, these messages can be very simple, they can be very raunchy, they can be very illuminating, to say the least. And lots of the messages end up in a very interesting situation where, you know what, I'm not gonna spoil it. Overlay, no spoil. It's my rule. I only wish that this manga had more adaptions to it. Now, if you definitely find this manga, you can find a few copies online, here and there, sure. But when it comes to outside market, domestically, it's very difficult to find. Price tag. What are we looking at the price tag at? We are looking around $5 to $30 per copy. So it's neither here nor there. It's one of these affordable gems. It's definitely something I'd like for anyone to read because it's fantastic. If it's your cup of tea, if you love the artwork, go ahead.
Labor. A robot specifically designed for heavy industrial work. The rise of labor's propagated a revolution in industry, but also in criminal activity. The police therefore created a special unit, the Patrol Labor, and thus, the birth of Pat Labor.
Oh yes, we are talking Pat Labor. When we talk Pat Labor, we talk about the fantastic cast of protagonists that drive this silly, comedic, yet action-filled adventure full of the police precinct that helps protect us from terrorist organizations that try to terrorize the town via mech. Now these mechs were made because of the rising tides of global warming and us needing more help than we can get, thus the creation of these mechs, though the creation as well of a police task force assigned to these incidents where people have taken advantage of these mechs and ensue evil. The plot is driven by our protagonist Noa Izumi, who abides by the letter of the law to help out her fellow man and sometimes get a cat stuck out of a tree. Though there is other great characters such as Chief Goto, the lazy yet not to be taken lightly chief that will most likely outsmart you any day of the week, as well as the rough around the edges character Asuma Shinohara, which is our go-to sidekick for Ms. Noa Izumi, I'd say. Now besides that, there's other characters that make this entire anime and manga what it is today. Yet, who created such a fantastic artwork? Well, none other than Masami Yuki, also known as Sato Shuji, who brings us such creations as Pangea no Musume Kuni, as well as Jajouma Grooming Up. It's so wholesome, it hurts. It's really wholesome, I'm sorry. Though, with this repertoire of wholesome manga being made, he also helps spearhead his anime projects of Pat Labor with his team Headgear, which also individually took on other projects like Ghost in the Shell, which can tell you a lot about who these people are and how much talent they have. Lots and lots of talent. They also go on to take on other such hits and small creations like the two OVAs for Twilight Q, of which if you're familiar with, you can see the resemblance in art as it is to Pat Labor. Now what does Masami Yuki do today? Well, he does design artwork, such as the character for a Megpoid Vocaloid, Gumi. If you're familiar with Vocaloids and love creating these Vocaloids as well as their music, you might be familiar with the Megpoid Vocaloid, Gumi. Now, who designed it? Well, Masami Yuki, creator of Pat Labor. Such a fantastic character, bright colors, bright face, and everything in between that makes Vocaloids what they are today. Though, the manga. We are talking 2 volumes of the 22 that were left untranslated by Viz Media, in which only 2 were made, given that they do have an actual reason for not creating any more. Money. The sales didn't do so great, it was given the axe after 2 volumes, which is difficult to say since overseas in Japan it did do extremely well. in the Sunday Shonen Weekly, it did break sales records of 19 million copies being sold. Now this was back in the 80s to 90s. It did do well and hold its own, and still does hold its own, against other record holders for the Shonen Weekly, such as One Piece, which sold more than a couple million copies than Pat Labor. But that's not to say it can't hold its own, because we have seen such hits from the series besides the anime, as it does have its own films as well as a live action. Now, the live action does dilly-dally up and down with its success, as it didn't do so successfully overseas, and it is seen somewhat of a flop. Now, Pat Labor the Next Generation, to me, is a fantastic work that does pay homage to Masamune Yuki and his fantastic work and characters that are still seen today as amazing. And as always, if you look at this art, if you love it, support it. Now, because these volumes didn't do so well in the States, yes, we only have two and they're more difficult to find nowadays. Though, price tag, we're talking $10 for used, $50 for new, if you like your pages more well kept and crisp. This one is difficult enough to find, as it's not typical to find these given their amount and given their cutoff status from Viz Media. Though pick this one up if you're still a rabid fan of Pat Labor. Now besides this, there is also lots of market still left for Pat Labor, as if you finished the anime and you thought it was over, I thought it was over, it wasn't over. If you finished the anime, you know that it leaves off at a big question. Though, that's not to say the question is left unanswered, as there is an OVA currently out right now that does continue to answer this question. There is another project in the works called Pat Labor EZY, which we know nothing about. Very little to no information has been given about this Pat Labor creation, and it excites me because we have yet to know anything about it. There's an illusion of mystery. What's behind there? What can we get more out of Pat Labor? What part of the story are we going to see? If you're a Pat Labor fan, do keep your ears perked to this one, as well as supporting Masamune Yuki's work. Now, let's go back in time a bit. Let's discuss the Edo period. Now, the Edo period doesn't have manga. Yes, it does. Now, when we discuss manga of the Edo period, we discuss Katsushika Hokusai, which did great artworks such as The Great Wave and The Red Fuji. Now, when we discuss these, I know everyone has seen these artworks, whether in some brochure, some picture off the internet, somewhere you've seen it, so you know the grand influence that Katsushika Hokusai holds. Now, besides that, yes, he did create manga. He created a couple of volumes so as to both gain a following of students to teach and to spread his name. Now, when he came out with these albums or these volumes of manga, they are not the manga we see today. You will not see a coherent plot. You will not see a telling of a cohesive story. It's just a discussion of nature. You see random pictures, hundreds and hundreds of random pictures of animals, vegetation, local gods, history, a little bit of everything that they talked about, that they enjoyed in their time. Now, why do I discuss this? Well, Katsushika Hokusai, as much as his paintings today have an influence, he does have an influence today in manga, in anime, and it's something that I don't want to miss in discussing. He has an influence in such a mobile game as Fate Grand Order, where he does have a character alongside his daughter Katsushika Oi, which do have a power-up that does pay an homage to The Great Wave, which I find visually enthralling to even see that somebody happens to throw in there. It's something that enthralls me because we have not forgotten. Now, we also see the telling of a great story, Miss Hokusai, in the film that came out a couple of years ago. Now, if you haven't caught this film yet, be sure to start that soon, as it is a fantastic work. It does see great visuals, it does see the telling of the stories of these paintings, of these gods, of these regular going-ons in their lives. It does pay great telling of this fantastic story. Now, as far as the manga that he created, the volumes and volumes of these, I'm not going to put a price tag on that, simply because if you find any original Hokusai, you're looking at something that's in a museum behind a glass. The price tag, just, I'm going to leave that as a question mark. Go away. Though this one is more as an homage itself of a discussion. I don't want to start a channel and not pay attention to every bit and detail that coins a term in anime and manga. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention everything and wanted to have this discussion with you. Though, if you happen to love and appreciate art, please appreciate some of the works that Hokusai has done, as well as his daughter. Moving on to the next one, Ultimate Venus. And when we discuss Ultimate Venus, we discuss a fantastic art of Takako Shigematsu, such a great artist that brought us Tenshi Janai, King of the Lamp, and 3 Meters from the Sun. Now these great pieces of art are followed by Ultimate Venus, that came out in 2007, that saw 9 volumes of release, only 5 being English translate. Now, it's one of these sort of Deiko the Zombie Shop-esque type of problems where it was midway translated, though a different reasoning as to why it didn't come to light with the rest of these. Now when we discuss Ultimate Venus, we discuss the story of Yuzu, who meets hardship from day one. Her mother having early passed on from the get-go of page one does leave a distraught Yuzu homeless. We do see, in a very comedic fashion, Miss Yuzu living under a playground slide, though from then on, it gets turned into a very Princess Diaries meets Who Wants to Be a Millionaire meets an officer and a gentleman. Well, besides that, she does get dragged into the story of her being the possible heir to a vast fortune from her grandmother. She does get taken in by her bodyguards, her many, many bodyguards, her many very pretty bodyguards. You do not take 3 steps without finding a very pretty man, very handsome. Do men often get called pretty? That's a very pretty man. That's a very pretty man. That's a very pretty man. Pretty, pretty, pretty everywhere. Though, as plot-driven as pretty men drive this, it's not to say that our protagonist Yuzu is your run-of-the-mill protagonist in these romances where she just accepts everything. She really doesn't. When it comes to running into the rest of her family, she takes things with more than a grain of salt. She fights things tooth and nail to understand them, to have others understand her. She also drives her life with her mother's sayings, and she calls them her mother's love and sayings. Now these sayings keep her life going, and they're more of isms to keep her life in check, like don't trust a very handsome person, or if someone starts a fight with you, they might as well remember it, or go for the balls. Yes, that's a saying for her. Though, it's in an essence sort of an NCIS Gibbs-ism, where you do see Gibbs live his way of life with his isms, in the same fashion that Yuzu and her mother, in her isms, gave her the responsibility to live by the way of those isms. I say it isms a lot, didn't I? Isms, 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 isms. Though besides that, this plot is very fantastic, not gonna spoil it too much, though the driving question in her mental war is, who can she trust? Can she trust her grandmother? Can she trust her family? Can she trust the bodyguards? Can she trust anything that anyone's ever said? the company GoComi Comics, the soul of manga, did go down with the citation of piracy being a prominent role, sadly enough. Now, this was back around 2005 to 2009. It was very sad to have seen them go and not seen the full translation of this, though bigger controversy surrounded GoComi Comics after their demise, as when their web domain went down and was up for sale again, somebody else bought it and pretended to be them, disgustingly, as they were not them. And when they took over the domain, they said such things as, "Hey, we're GoComi and we're gonna bring the whole company back. We're making a PayPal, and if you donate whatever you can, then yes, we'll use those funds to bring back the company," which is such a flat out lie, because these people were not them, and even the creative director had to come out for that website, that the original GoComi website, and say, "You are not us. Who are you and why are you doing this?" After that broke out, they did get taken down. Now, whether people donated to them, difficult to say. But if they did, I am so sorry that they did, because to pretend to be them, not just the artist, not just the work of art, but the entirety of the people who worked diligently to bring you all this manga translated, have it be enjoyed, have the authors work with them and everything, just be flat out taken over by some scumbags who wanted to make a quick buck. It riles me, because it's an insult for this company to be taken down by piracy and then be taken over by impersonators who had the gall to even try this. Okay, besides that, sorry, I have to collect myself. I get very riled from insults like that. The manga itself. Price tag. What are we looking at? $5 for one, for individual volumes of the five, and 20 for the collective. Not too much of a piggy bank breaker, but if you do own this fantastic book of art, I am jelly of you. Simply because when I read this one, I stopped around volume 3 or 4, and it does keep driving the plot, and each volume ends in cliffhangers. I desperately want to keep reading this, but as it is, there is a full translation in both Japanese and French, as France does have a big following for this manga. Now, it's known as a different name. It's known as Big Bang Venus. Now, those different price different, they're worth around $7 to $9 in France for each one of them, but given that I can't reach French or Japanese, it really upsets me. Boo. Though if you do have the first five volumes, fantastic on you. Very jelly. I want them so bad. And now we arrive to the last book. Manga de Dokuha. Yes, the thumbnail that drove your curiosity is also known as Reading Through Manga, brought to you by East Press and Kosuke Maruo. Now, Kosuke Maruo, as well as East Press, dabbles in classic literature and bringing it to a manga art style. Now, we're not just talking Mein Kampf here, we're talking Shakespeare, the Iliad, Homer, The Art of War, Darwin, Dostoevsky, Don Quixote, Les Miserables, Das Kapital, The Communist Manifesto, Theory of Relativity, and the list goes on and on and on. Though the point is, what they're trying to do is engage the younger audience into reading books that they otherwise would have never tried to read. Now, it's very simple and easy to say why this book is so controversial, as well as very rare, given that it was banned outright in many countries and wasn't sold anywhere outside of Japan, Brazil, and I think Turkey for the most part. Now, when this manga was being sold in Japan, it was sold at your local 7-Elevens, which is funnily enough, though they did sell out quickly, though have not seen a republication since. Now, there has been some clamor to have them republish them again, but East Press has not said much and has remained mum on whether they'll republish it again. But besides that, East Press, as well as Kosuke Maruo, has also published other controversies such as the Quran, the Bible, as well as Das Kapital and the Communist Manifesto. Now, when it comes to this, it did rub a lot of people the wrong way. The Israeli Prime Minister Nissim Ben-Shitrit did not mince words when he's quoted as saying, "When I saw the drawing of Hitler with swastikas and Japanese captions, I was shocked. It's unthinkable that an enlightened person would read Hitler's book. Luckily, the book has exhausted itself and is no longer on the shelves." The Israeli Prime Minister is not the only one to have spoken out about this issue very vocally. The Japanese liaison to Bavaria, Toshio Obata, did also have his say in it, and quoting and saying, "Even 60 years after the end of the war, Nazism remains a sensitive issue in Germany. Did East Press exhaust discussions before publishing it? Did it consider the difference between Japan and Germany as to how manga is viewed as a medium?" And yet, even then, Masuo-san did happen to rebuke some of these criticisms in saying in his own words, "I think it is studying material for Knowing Hitler, A Man Synonymous with the Devil, and what sort of thinking created that level of tragedy. We think this will provide clues about Hitler as a human being, as to his way of thinking that led to such a tragedy, even though he was dismissed as a monster. The idea is to give the reader the possibility to read a classic and understand the concepts in just 1 hour. The idea is not to present Hitler as a villain or a hero, but just to show who he was and what he thought. We are not worried about the controversy. In addition, everyone already knows the whole story and how the Nazis thought." Now, this was in 2008. This was not 2015 when the copyright for Mein Kampf went into public domain. Now, the reasoning as to how they got away with it in 2008 was via the Berne Convention. Under the Berne Convention for the Protection of Artistic and Literary Works, it does state that if something was published before 1970 and hasn't been republished for at least 10 years, it can be republished. East Press did take advantage of this and did go on to publish the work of Mein Kampf. Now, when we look at the visuals, we do see the telling of Mein Kampf via the main players for this war, the right-hand men of Hitler, as well as the telling of how, as a child, he lost his family and lost more meaning than he could imagine. Though there's other people who actually back and support this work, as a Mr. Martin Kaling from the Financial Times of the East Asia's correspondent for Germany also states that he finds this manga interesting and very informative, also going on the record as to saying, "It's a new approach. There's a risk in using cartoon images and text to tell this story, but the book is an important document because it's Hitler's manifesto, and it's important that people try to understand his thinking in a critical way." Now, some people remain very vocal about the issue of Mein Kampf and its reprinting in general, such as German professor and historian Clemens Vollenhardt, who also opposes the ban of the republication of Mein Kampf, and also had to say, and I quote, "The banning of books is a serious problem in a free society. The ban of Hitler's Mein Kampf may have been justified in the early years after the war, but now we have a totally different situation. Mein Kampf has no magic qualities. It is a badly written book, but it offers a deep insight into Hitler's thinking." The ambassador from earlier that we discussed, Nissim Ben-Shitrit of Israel, also had kinder words for them in an understanding, saying, "I don't think that they maliciously intended to publish something anti-Semitic. It's a small company that publishes manga books, and they thought the readers would be interested in it." Now, throughout history, we have these conversations because of literature. In history, we see in times of great crisis, we burn books outright, not wanting to gain any knowledge in them. We also have seen the tragedies of Charlie Hebdo, where we have the discussion of what can be insensitive, what can be informative, what can be reflective, what we can discuss whatsoever. Now, because of these, I can appreciate what East Press is trying to do. They're trying to bridge a conversation with us and a younger audience that would have never partaken in such conversations. Now, East Press also goes on to achieve other controversies. As I mentioned earlier, they did publish the Quran, and they also came out with a statement for that, saying, and I quote, The word Islam is often heard in the daily news, but because we Japanese aren't usually familiar with it, a perverted image of Islam as abstemious or linked to terrorism is liable to persist. So what kind of teachings do Muslims actually believe in? What are they thinking about? To understand the modern international community of Islam, let's try to experience the scriptures where all this is written down. Now, since publishing that, it did have a Muslim audience to it, and some Muslims did come over to say, yes, we actually enjoyed this book and we enjoyed the works of East Press, and gained a following from them. And as I was ranting on earlier, I enjoy that we can have these conversations, that we can trade our thoughts on it, because if we're not going to discuss them now, when will we? Now, I see what you're trying to do, East Press. You're opening this can of worms. You are informing the younger public. You are informing all these different people of different nationalities and of different creeds what the facts and figures are for each book in a more understandable medium. Now, for that, I have no problem. And I see what you're doing, I support it. If you support it as well, I'm not even going to say it anymore. Just support any way you can. Now, before I get to the price tag, I just want to say, the reason I bring this book up whatsoever is to have that discussion with you, to have that conversation that East Press also indulges in. They want to talk to their audience via these drawings, these animations, and these great works of art. But under no circumstance do I believe in or do I support this particular man's agenda. I do not support Nazism, and I do not support any other far-right agenda that seeks to harm other people. When we discuss the ideals of harming someone else's way of life simply because it doesn't coexist with yours, that is not my ideal, and I firmly stand against it. Now, finally arriving to price tag. Now, the price completely varies, as when I tried to look this one up, because of the countries that it was banned in, where you could find it was very difficult. And you will definitely find it overseas, but you're not going to find it at your Barnes & Noble or anything. Though the price, because of the rarity and scarceness of it, can go from 50 to, I've seen sometimes 80, back down to 8, up to 10, up to, it's like I'm looking at the stock market or something. But if you're going to purchase this one, I do suggest heavily that you do so because it's an informative point of view that you are wanting to partake in this literature. Now, brushing up on my homework a bit, I did contact a YouTuber, a Mr. Tay Lee, a very fine young man. He is a connoisseur of manga, and he did happen to buy this book online a couple of years ago. Now, ever since then, he says he's forgotten what website he bought it from. He's even forgotten where he's placed the book. Though, he did a review on YouTube for it, and there will be links down below for that, as well as him telling me that he did read the story and he did find it fascinating to read upon Hitler's youth and what drove him to such extreme ideals. And to you, Mr. Taylor, if you're watching, good on you for having an eye of literature. I hope we could talk more soon, as I am very piqued in interest if you have any more recommendations for me. I like to read a lot. I'm not sorry. Now, besides that, a final two-bit segment before I end this video, as I've discussed all the manga for today. Two quick things. I want to discuss quick bits. Quick bits are just fun little facts that I want to drop in, just to keep things alive and interesting of manga and anime and things that maybe you didn't know. I don't know. I'm a nerd for facts and figures and stuff. Anywho, let's start with the quick bits. Quick bits 1 through 3. Quick bit 1. When submitting the first volume to Ms. Kobayashi's Dragon Maid, according to the bonus material at the end of the first volume, written and illustrated by Kokyo Shinja, Kokyo and the magazine editor that met originally decided to make a boy meets girl romance for their manga contract. Yet when Kokyo presented the first chapter of Dragon Maid instead, the editor was completely confused. Yet, when initially discussing this, he rolled with it anyway. Quick bit 2. When discussing the creation of fairy tale character Wendy Marvel, her first concept art shows that she initially had a wand, a tattoo on the opposite shoulder, and oddly enough, wasn't a wind dragon slayer, but a water dragon slayer, a detail that was later changed of her character. And for the last quick bit, when discussing My Hero Academia and its main protagonist Midoriya, his original name was going to be Mikomo Akatani. With longer curly hair more reminiscent of eraser heads, he would have remained quirkless instead of receiving one for all, and instead being a gadget genius, making numerous gadgets out of materials he scrunched up to keep up with the rest of his class. A gadget personality that we see more today in Hatsume Mei, whose gadgets are her babies. And now we arrive to the last segment of our show, which is Artist Corner, where I eat my own words, and instead of just yammering on about support, I actually support an artist. Now, today's artist is Ms. Emine Hime-sama, who comes to us from Chile and brings us fantastic art. Now, this mangaka has a love, has a passion, has a whirlwind of a flurry of talent, because if you look through all of her posts, either on Facebook or on YouTube or on her DeviantArt, you can see where the love is and where the love goes. You can tell that there was late nights staying up of grey wrist, where you get the pencil marks all over you and you try to wash it off and it quite does and it quite doesn't. You can see it, you can smell the lead of the pencils. But besides that, if you love and support that, by all means, even just dropping a like on one of her posts or just commenting, hey, me encantó tu arte, then yeah, by all means, do so. And if you have a more fantastic approach to it and you want to help her buy some erasers and some pencils and some pens, by all means, her links are down below to her Patreon as well. Now, besides that, she does do some YouTube tutorials here and there. Links to that, as well as having her own manga. She does have two volumes out right now for her manga, Twilling, the fantastic slice of life of two twins that lead on a charming yet intrinsic life of aberrations from their friends and their love lives and their school days and their Nietzsche Joes, and it's enrapturing because I've already read the first two volumes and it's fantastic and I want more. But it's addictive. It's like pistachios. I mean, have you ever had just one pistachio? No. But though, word of caution is that it is only in Spanish. And a question for you, Ms. Emine Hime-sama. Si está viendo este video, señora Emine Hime-sama, le pregunto, ¿va a haber una transacción para Twilling? Que los primeros volúmenes que han salido ahorita, o que están disponibles ahorita, nomás están en español. Si puede haber una transacción para inglés, creo que nos ayudará a abrir esa conversación con los que quieren leer su creación o sus creaciones en su lenguaje, que no creo que todos podamos hablar español y nos podemos ayudar juntos a los que quieren leer con nosotros. Y antes de que se me olvide, saludos señora Emine Hime-sama, saludos desde Texas. Y para los que están viendo desde Chile o desde un país que habla español, hola. Si quieren soportar al señor Emine Hime-sama, o nomás quieren mandarle un like, o un comento, o mandarle su amor, entonces aquí están sus páginas aquí abajo. Y también, si quieren ayudarla a comprar cosas como materiales, como lápices y borradores, y cosas que la ayuden a crear más de su fantástico arte que es tan hermoso, entonces ayúdenle como pueden en su Patreon. Y yeah, that's a wrap for me. That was Artist Corner. And if you loved this video, if you liked it, if you have some comments for me, if you want to know more information about Ms. Emine Hime-sama, by all means, comment down below, leave a like, leave whatever you can, and I will get to it promptly. And if you have any more ideas, or if you want to discuss an anime or a manga that you saw on this video, and just want to talk about it, by all means reach out to me. And if you have any more ideas on like manga you want to see in the next video, by all means I will still keep on the topic of rare mangas, rarities and scarcities, as well as other topics I will get to soon as well. I'm not going to spoil it because I don't believe in spoilers. Now, besides that, it might take me a little bit of time to come back to the channel, as bills and school and the job, and y'all know how it is. Ugh. But thank you for sticking around. This was supposed to be a 10-minute video, but it enraptured into some behemoth of a video full of 36-37 minutes worth of facts and trivia. I told you guys, I love trivia and stuff. If you don't believe me, now you really can. But thank you for sticking around, thank you for watching. Go support the artists that you saw in this video, as all the links will be down below. And I will catch you guys next time. Thank you for watching. Now is your cue to click out. Go. Walk your dog and do the dishes, the piling up. Go watch Citrus. Go support My Hero Academia. Go plus Ultra. Yes. Go. What are you still doing here? Go. Go away. Go. Do stuff. Go play stick and hoop. So I guess to do these days. Don't. Maybe. I don't know. Go play Persona 5. Go. Persona 5. Yeah. I don't know. Go. Bye.